The location, on the Mississippi River near Memphis, Tennessee. The problem, strong currents are caving the banks and shifting the course of the river. The treatment, protection of the riverbank to prevent further caving. Not far from Vicksburg, Mississippi, the main navigation channel is narrowed and shallowed by sandbars. The problem is complicated by divided flow and the secondary channel. The treatment, dredging to enlarge the main channel, plus a dike system to close the secondary channel. Just above New Orleans, Louisiana, the problem, a levee so near the river that it could be destroyed. Constant wave action washes away the land between the river and the levee. The treatment, concrete paving for the levee. A stone dike for restoring the land. These are some of the problems and treatments in controlling the behavior of the nation's greatest river, the Mississippi. The treatment varies with the problem, and the successful treatment could be called a prescription for a river. This is the lower Mississippi as it flows from Cairo, Illinois, south to the Gulf of Mexico. Powerful river currents cave or erode the soft banks, sometimes slowly. Sometimes in great chunks, banks have caved back 100 feet or more in a single day. Most of the land dumped in the river through this caving process is carried downstream to form sandbars. These bars shift and grow. Channels become clogged with sand, making navigation more difficult during low water months. In all, 1,000 miles of meandering river, a powerful river that is always trying to change its course. Over a period of several thousand years, the lower Mississippi has carved its way back and forth across the valley lowlands many times. Before civilization reached the valley, this uncontrolled wandering of the river didn't matter. But during the past century, as the valley has been populated and developed, it has become of paramount importance to control this river, to protect the people and their investments, and to provide a stable, dependable channel for waterborne commerce. To find the best means of doing this, the river has been accurately mapped and studied. Although its movements are often unpredictable, generally the river acts this way. In the bends, strong currents attack the banks, caving them into the channel. Most of this material settles along the bank a short distance below the area of caving, and in the next crossing. A crossing is where the main current flows from one bank to the opposite bank. This action can be seen as a trading process from banks to bars. The banks continue to cave, and the bars continue to build. If this caving is not stopped, the levees protecting the land will eventually be reached and destroyed. Levees are man-made walls of earth, the main line of defense against flooding. They stand between the river and valleys, cities, industries, and fertile lands. There are about 1,700 miles of levees along the lower Mississippi, most of them well back from the river. Often distance is not enough. Some levees have been breached even though originally they were located several miles from the river. A temporary solution is a levee setback, building another levee farther from the river. But this is only buying time. it does not solve the problem of bank caving, and it does not prevent the loss of valuable land. The big problem has been to find a prescription to stabilize the river, not only for flood control, but also for navigation, since a river stabilized in a suitable alignment and of sufficiently contracted width is the prelude to developing a low water channel that can be maintained with minimum effort and cost. So, the prescription must first determine the best alignment, then move the river into this position, and finally, fix it there. For the lower Mississippi River, the most desirable alignment is a succession of easy curves or bends with the natural width of the low water channel reduced to maintain suitable navigation depths. This river's characteristics divided into two major sections, the part lying between Cairo and Baton Rouge, and the section from Baton Rouge to the Gulf. Each of these presents its own stabilization problems. For example, in this unimproved section above Baton Rouge, there were a number of problems. It was a long, wide, straight reach, ending in a sharp bend. Characteristically, caving banks upstream caused sandbars to form. These bars split the flow and would move with each high and low water cycle. There was no well-defined navigation channel in the straight reach. The sharp bend was difficult to navigate because the bar formation extending into the bend forced the channel to make an abrupt turn. A plan was developed to confine the flow into a single channel and alter the sharp bend into an easy one. The first task was to stabilize by revetment those banks already in the desired alignment. Revetment is a protective covering placed on the riverbank to prevent caving. In constructing it, the bank is first cleared of trees above and below the water. The bank is then graded to a stable slope. This slope is extended smoothly out into the river. The underwater portion of the revetment consists of flat concrete blocks connected by wire embedded in them when they are made. These are assembled into a large, flexible mattress. It is launched continuously over the side of a special barge. The mattress, which makes up about three-fourths of the revetment, covers the bank below the water surface, sometimes as much as 600 feet out into the channel. The bank above the mattress is paved with broken stone to protect it during periods of high water. The planned placing of revetment illustrates how the river's energy is used to achieve proper alignment. This partial protection, for instance, stabilized the upper part of the bend. But below the revetment, the bank continued to cave. As the river caved the bank into the planned alignment, more sections of revetment were added. This stopped the bank caving. Then the problem was to develop a channel in the straight reach and the crossing. To do this, a series of barriers called dikes was added to direct the current and consolidate the bars. In this case, dikes have been placed to close off the secondary channel. The dikes caused the current to slow down and drop some of its load of sand and silt. When the river deposits enough material within the dike field, the secondary channel will be blocked. In this way, dikes are used to contract the width of the low water channel and direct it into a more suitable alignment. There are many kinds of barriers used in river engineering. Stone dikes, for instance, perform much the same as pile dikes. They are easy to build and require little upkeep. Sometimes a combination of the two types is used. With dikes in place to narrow its width, the river's energy began to deepen the channel, a valuable assist in achieving and keeping low water navigation depths. To complete the permanent channel, dredging was used to clear away all remaining obstructions and help fill the dike fields. Dredges, such as this cutterhead type, dig and remove material from the channel. Loosened by the rotating cutter head, the material is sucked up with large pumps, discharged through a long pipeline, and deposited out of the channel. This material is used in many ways to build up the land, such as filling dike fields and closing secondary channels. Following dredging, it was necessary to add more dikes to close the old channel completely. The total effect of these controls was a better alignment, a riverbed with a well-defined and stabilized low-water channel suitable for navigation, and a high-water channel broad enough to take care of flood flows. Most important, it was a permanent channel that could be easily maintained for both flood control and navigation. Yet this does not tell the whole story, because there are different problems from Baton Rouge to the Gulf. Here, the Mississippi is deeply entrenched, and the land is highest near the river, sloping off into swampland farther back. So it is on this narrow strip of usable ground, often less than a mile wide on each side of the river, that urban and industrial developments must be located. And the levees, too, are built on the firm foundation near the water's edge. Because of the limited foreshore, that is, the land between the levee and the river, there is little margin for even a slight shift of the channel. There is also the problem of wave wash caused by winds and passing ships, particularly during high water. Waves erode the slope of the levee. To prevent this, the slope is paved with a concrete slab or with stone. At some locations where bank caving has not yet endangered the levee, and there is enough land remaining between the river and the levee, a standard flexible revetment placed while the water is low is all that is necessary to prevent further caving. Where the foreshore has been washed away and the levee protection undermined, additional treatment is needed. So rock dikes are built parallel to the base of the levee to rebuild the land by trapping and holding silt during high water. These newly installed foreshore dikes provide immediate protection from wave action caused by wind and passing ships. The land is rebuilt at the rate of about 1 foot each year. Later, the restored foreshore becomes overgrown with willows, giving added protection. Controlling a river the size of the lower Mississippi is not an easy job. There is much yet to be done, both in building the control works and in experimenting, researching, and applying new ways of doing the job at less cost. There are still many miles of revetment to be placed. and dike systems to be constructed. Much dredging must be done to improve the alignment and to maintain navigation depths until the river can do this work itself. Especially below Baton Rouge, where the levees are most vulnerable, more protection work is needed. Whatever it takes, one thing is certain. These controls are working. River traffic is constantly on the increase, taking advantage of a more efficient and dependable navigation channel. Industry is moving to the river's banks because of an increasing confidence in the levees and other flood control works that protect the land, an unlimited supply of fresh water, and the availability of reliable barge and ship transportation. Man is at last taking full advantage of America's greatest waterway by means of a reliable prescription for a river.